Hey, DieAnt Nation. So, Super Mario Galaxy is very good. Bye.
Whoa. Hold on, I'm not done yet. Super Mario Galaxy is...
Super Mario Galaxy, much like Mario 64, needs no introduction. Not only is it one of the greatest video games of all time, but you can argue that it's the greatest Mario game, even the single greatest platformer ever made. I mean, I'm not making that argument, I'm a Mario Sunshine guy, so my opinion is garbage anyway, but on a purely objective level, Mario Galaxy is truly in a league of its own. It's so good that I have a hard time even talking about it. It's very good, what else is there to say? Honestly, anything else just feels redundant in a way. But they're putting Mario down this month, so I'm still gonna try. With all that being said, here are my thoughts on Super Mario Galaxy. Very good game. Let's go back a bit.
Oh, thank God.
Super Mario Galaxy released in November 2007 worldwide, with the 12th being the lucky day for us here in the States.
See, November feels like the right time to put out a Mario game. Like, can you imagine if it came out in August? That would have been absurd!
The concept of Mario woo-hooing all around planets was a natural result of ideas introduced in the Super Mario 128 tech demo. That demo included the mechanic of walking around spherical objects, so the developers decided to copy off of their old work, making for the first time that Mario would visit space, if you don't count Super Mario Land 2 and Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door and Mario Kart Super Circuit and Mario's Time Machine. And after a bit of hesitation with the idea of platforming in space, the developers quickly figured out how to execute the concept, and they enjoyed the creative freedom that the new setting provided them. Because the thought of a B Mario in the Mushroom Kingdom? Bullshit, preposterous, that would only make sense in the B galaxies! Nintendo knew they had something special on their hands with Galaxy. In fact, according to former Nintendo of America president Reggie Fils-Aimé,
"While every Mario game is a classic, in one sense, this is the first worthy successor to Super Mario 64.
Funny enough, as Nintendo later acknowledged during the run-up to Super Mario Odyssey, the Galaxy games aren't really direct sequels to 64 and Sunshine. Instead, they exist in their own little 2D-3D hybrid haberdashery, much like Super Mario 3D World. These games are much more focused on linear level design than freeform exploration, so in a way, Reggie was always kind of wrong with that statement.
So Reggie just threw Sunshine under the bus in order to lie! Cool! Reggie!
Super Mario Galaxy released to critical and commercial success, and is still considered to be one of the greatest video games of all time.
Enough with the history lesson, when do we get to talk about me?!
So, being fully honest, Galaxy kinda came at the wrong time for me growing up. I got it when I was maybe 12 or 13 years old, and it was a game that I played and liked. I didn't run around its worlds endlessly, or feel a connection to any of the levels or mechanics or whatever like I did with 64 and Sunshine, no, but I had a decent amount of fun just completing the actual game. I even 100%ed it as a young lad, which I can't even say about 64 or Sunshine. Only as Mario though, but I'm still saying I 100%ed it, just let me have this, okay? It counts! But I slowly found myself playing video games less and less around that time. The only modern systems I owned were a Wii and a DS Lite, and perhaps as a consequence of that, I felt myself morphing into the dreaded casual gamer that Nintendo was targeting during that era, mainly using both systems for games like Wii Sports and Mario Kart.
Sorry!
Maybe because of all of these factors, or maybe because Mario Galaxy isn't a big open sandbox of a game that I could just jump back into again and again like its predecessors, it didn't leave much of an impression on me. And because of that, over the last decade I've developed the dumb belief that I was never a fan of this game at all, since whenever it came up in conversation, my only thought was, yup, I played that and can't remember a single thing about it. Except the Bowser fights, those were really good. So when Nintendo announced the 3D All-Stars collection, it wasn't exactly the most exciting moment of the trailer for me. But then I got the game, and after playing some Mario 64, and then spending a few days playing through Sunshine, finally I got to Galaxy, 100%ed it again, and enjoyed every single moment of it. Well, again, only as Mario.
It counts!
As I said, Super Mario Galaxy, to me, is just a very good game, and I still find myself struggling to say much more than that. It features very good levels, very good missions and mechanics and ideas, very good controls, a very good camera, all things considered.
You get the point.
Weirdly enough, an aspect of this game that I can easily talk about are the bosses, especially the Bowser fights. That's right, I'm starting off by talking about boss fights, you can't stop me! These Bowser fights, to me, are easily the best in the series. Mechanically, they're fairly straightforward, but their scope and presentation elevate them beyond anything else we've ever seen in a Mario game. It also doesn't hurt that these fights have some real stakes attached to them. In this game's very good story, Bowser isn't just kidnapping Peach because he's trying to marry her or acting like she's Junior's mom or whatever, no. For some reason, he actually wants to take over the universe, not just the Mushroom Kingdom, but like, everything? Why? What happened after Mario destroyed your bathtub, my man? Did you run into debt? Where was I? Oh, yeah, Bowser boss fights and the platforming sections leading up to them that are very reminiscent of Mario 64's. They're so memorable, exciting, so very good. And then the non-Bowser boss fights? Oh my god, they're also very good. They're all uniquely designed and feature interesting gameplay mechanics. A few of them have a real sense of scale that I really like, and some of them can be surprisingly challenging, you know, as far as Mario games are concerned. As I said, they're very good. And you know one thing about this game that's even better than very good? The fully orchestrated soundtrack, which is by far one of the greatest video game soundtracks of all time. These tracks are incredible, and they range from being quaint and low-key to intense and bombastic, but each perfectly accompanies the level or challenge they're paired with, and they're all insanely catchy to boot. I really don't think there's a single bad song in the whole game, not one that feels even remotely dull or unnecessary, which is pretty remarkable. I think it's fair to say that the music is Galaxy's single greatest quality, and that's truly saying something. Plus, thanks to the game's large level count, we get many more tracks to drown in than previous Mario titles. Compared to Mario 64's 15 levels and Sunshine's whopping 7, Galaxy features 42 smaller, more streamlined galaxies, each possessing between 1 and 7 power stars. In addition, this game features the Comet Observatory hub world, which, honestly, this place is just pathetic. Besides a few hidden 1-ups and the neat way that it gradually lights up as you unlock new sections of it, there is absolutely nothing to see here, and I would have preferred there being no hub at all as opposed to this sad husk. That is all I have to say about the observatory, and I will never speak of it again. But back to the levels, I won't bother going through them one by one like I did with 64 and Sunshine, because you'll be hearing the words very good so many times in a row that you'll probably just click out of the video. Except for Dusty Dune Galaxy, I don't know, maybe it's just my desert prejudice talking here, but I'm also not big into some of the mechanics in this galaxy either. Not a bad level at all, but just, you know, not as very good as the others. I'm truly sorry, Dusty Dune Galaxy fans. But in terms of the levels as a whole, while some galaxies do feature a bit of breathing room akin to the previous two games' more open worlds, there is a whole lot of linearity in this outing. The objective for nabbing each star is pretty much always going to be some form of platform from one end of the stage to the other while engaging with unique mechanics that are often gravity-based. Good job. While as a kid, I think I preferred the bigger galaxies for their very faint sense of open exploration, as a less kid-age Anthony today, I've grown a fondness for the galaxies that are as tight and direct as humanly possible. I really appreciate the game's refined-to-the-bone stage design and pure focus on platforming, and it's where things truly excel here. It's also where Mario's more limited movement makes the most sense. In terms of new moves, in addition to the gimped return of 64's long jump, backflip, and crawling, especially crawling, I like when he crawled like a big old baby, not whatever the f*** this is. The new entree on the proverbial platter is the Galaxy Spin, a move that is so helpful and satisfying to use that I can't believe this is the first Mario game it's ever been in. It gives you just a little bit of wiggle room while platforming, and it's useful for all sorts of other situations, such as combat. It's the first thing that comes to mind whenever I think about this game now, and also, why in the frickin' heck is it not a part of Mario's Smash moveset yet. But while Mario's movement options are fine, actually moving around is a bit less so. It's simply not very fun or satisfying to run around aimlessly here like it was in 64 and Sunshine. It feels like any forward momentum you build up is constantly being taken away from you, which works well for the linear stages but creates a bit of a disconnect for me when you're expected to trek around the wider areas like Honey Hive Galaxy. It's not horrible, in fact it's not even bad, but it does feel like a bit of a downgrade unfortunately. And speaking of unfortunately's, the power-ups! Man, these power-ups... So a lot of people complain about Yoshi's implementation in Mario Sunshine, because rather than functioning as a fun addition to your regular movement like in the 2D games, using him limits what you can do as base Mario and ends up feeling unnecessary as a result. While I do agree that Yoshi isn't implemented well in that game, I still think that he's fun to use, because controlling him can get pretty chaotic and nutty in its own special way. But Galaxy's power-ups to me are just an even worse version of what people don't like about Sunshine Yoshi. The fun or useful ones like the Fire Flower and Flying are locked to a strict timer and feel like they're never actually used for anything. Seriously, how did a Mario game f*** up the Fire Flower? And the less fun ones like B and Boo Mario severely limit the base controls when you use them, like why the hell can't you long jump as B Mario, and why is Boo Mario so slow? I mean, are the costumes cute?
Oh my god, yes!
But does that make them worth it when they hinder the actual gameplay to this extent?
A little bit.
So overall, I don't love how Mario feels in and of itself, but despite all of that, he somehow still manages to control absolutely perfectly when you're actually playing the game. Like, Galaxy Mario obviously wouldn't work in Sunshine, sure, but at the same time, Sunshine Mario would feel completely wrong in this game as well, even without my best friend Flood wrecking the house. Galaxy has a lot of tight sections and challenges that are truly weird with their gravity that still feel novel even today, so the game did have to take back some player control in order to make these sections a little more manageable to work through, especially for the wider audience that Nintendo was targeting with this outing. It's admirable how they managed to create a more scaled-back moveset that still functions as well as it does, because when I actually play the game, none of my complaints really matter, it all just works flawlessly. But in addition to regular movement, Galaxy features a few motion-based hijinks as well. Thankfully, there aren't a ton of them in the game, or else I think they'd end up feeling pretty stinky, but here are my brief thoughts on each of them regardless. I don't care for any pointer-based movement like the bubble and pole star nonsense. It all bores me and slows down the pace, but it's not a hate crime or anything. The mana ray's fine, and oh my fucking god, the star ball! Look, I know I'm in the minority here, but controlling this stupid ball is the closest that the game gets to feeling like Mario Sunshine in terms of absolutely stressful bullshit that I love to death. It is so much dumb fun, and I swear to you now I'll find an excuse to make a 20-minute video just about the ball one day. But with all due respect to my big beautiful ball, Mario Galaxy is a game that's truly at its best when it's prioritizing exceptional level design above all else. You'll be jumping between planetoids, walking on walls and ceilings, floating through the air, and so much more, and I can't emphasize how absolutely, painfully very good it all is. None of these levels are a chore to get through, there are no bad ideas, and they all stick around just long enough to feel satisfying without wearing themselves out. The main exception to this, you know, besides Dusty Doom Galaxy, sorry, are the prankster comets, aka the repetition comets. They're all just lazy ways to recycle content, such as having to beat a boss without getting bonked or having to race a slow cosmic Mario Il Pontissimo style. But despite these being repetitive, they aren't bad at all, and I do have enough fun completing them, with one major exception being the purple comets. The purple comets, for those out of the loop, are basically just remixed versions of the 100 coin stars from 64 and Sunshine. However, these purple comets come in two unique varieties. Some where you have a time limit to collect 100 purple coins out of a total of 150 or so, which are actually a lot of fun, and some where you have to collect exactly 100 purple coins out of a total of exactly 100 purple coins, and these can go f*** right off. It's absolutely disgusting that these exist, especially considering the fact that, like I said, I don't enjoy running around as Mario just for the sake of it, which these levels inherently require that you do. These challenges are especially lazy, and the developers were kind enough to hide some individual coins in some truly jank places, meaning that you can find 99 of them and then have to spend 5 minutes of your dumb Anthony life combing for the last one. I would argue that these are the most frustrating part of the entire game, and they rival any of the repetitive garbage 64 and Sunshine threw at us, but to be honest, if this is the absolute worst that the game has to offer, then it's obviously a very good game, you know what I mean? Because that's the thing about Galaxy. When I talked about Super Mario 64, I called it a masterpiece of its time that hasn't aged as gracefully as I wish it did. And when I talked about Super Mario Sunshine, I said that that could have been a masterpiece, but its rushed development and broken elements hold it back from being truly great. Well, Super Mario Galaxy is a true masterpiece to the surprise of nobody who's ever played it. It's so painfully good that that's really all somebody like me can say about it. Because I do agree that Galaxy is very good, obviously. It's easily and indisputably the best game in the 3D All-Stars collection, even if it's not my favorite game out of the bunch. It's the most polished, the most beautiful, and the most well-done game of the three, and it continues to age like fine wine both technically and visually. Seriously, playing this game in widescreen feels like it could have come out within the last year. It's pure eye candy from start to finish. But that's why I have less to say about it than the previous two games. It's just so overwhelmingly good in every single way, such a masterpiece, but at the same time, my mind goes blank whenever I try to think any deeper about it. I don't have as much of a personal connection with this game, less moments of it stand out in my mind, and despite how great it is, it still doesn't leave as much of an impression on me as games like 64 and Sunshine did. I totally recognize that nostalgia has a lot to do with this, but I've played tons of games outside of my childhood that have more than lodged their way into my brain. Games like Undertale, Hollow Knight, and Breath of the Wild are not only masterpieces that I played as a non-kid adult, but they're games that I could easily write 100-page dissertations about, you know, for money. But Mario Galaxy, it's just not that for me, but I think that's okay. It's a very good game that I recognize as very good, and there's nothing wrong with that, I think. It's an absolute masterpiece, and that's just about all I have to say about it. Oh well, maybe I'll have more thoughts about Super Mario Galaxy 2. Let me just pop in 3D All-Stars and... Welcome to the final section of this video, where I complain just a bit more about the garbage 3D All-Stars collection, starting with the fact that it's only available until Okay, first of all, pulling back the curtain for a second, I work on these videos months in advance, so I have no idea if Nintendo is gonna end up changing their mind about this, but as of now, the concept of selling a video game for a very limited time, especially digitally, is so bizarrely, brazenly fucked up that I really can't wrap my head around it. Actually, no, screw what I said about them changing their mind, because even if they do decide to keep selling this game, screw Nintendo forever using this manipulative Disney Vault bullshit to boost sales of three of their most beloved games. The 3D collection would have sold like hotcakes whether it was a limited release or not, but I guess that just wasn't enough for them, was it?
But hey now,
some people actually say with their mouths,
6 months is plenty of time to buy a video game, and if people don't buy it now, they can just grab a copy off eBay later. What's the big deal?
The big deal is that it's gross and disappointing and such an anti-consumer decision for them to make, and it cuts into the concept of celebrating Mario's anniversary at all. Look, I know a thing or two about capitalism, okay? Nintendo is a business focused on making money. They're not our friend, they can do whatever the hell they want, but that doesn't mean they should. They're alienating their core audience and enabling scalpers just to make a few extra bucks. It's disrespectful not only to their fans, but to their legacy content as well, and I'm sorry, but Mario just deserves better than this. But what makes it so much worse is the absolutely abysmal quality of the collection in itself. I can live with the bare bones menu and lack of extra features, though. It's disappointing that they couldn't even add in some concept art or developer interviews or a pause button for the soundtracks. But the celebration of Mario's 35th anniversary just feels like a moist piece of cake with a burnt candle sticking out of it. Sure, moist cake is still cake and it might even taste good, but is it wrong for us to want cake that isn't wet? Nintendo could have gone in and only fine-tuned Mario 64's camera and made it widescreen, and I would have been happy, despite all of its other problems. They could have added some quality of life upgrades to Sunshine, like a map for the blue coins and the ability to skip cutscenes, and I still would have been happy, even if it was still a broken mess. And for Galaxy, they could have... Well, Galaxy still holds up really well, I don't really have any complaints about that one. But instead, they upgraded some of the menu icons and graphics, use the version of Mario 64 without the backwards long jump. That'll be $60, please.
But they added GameCube controller support for Sunshine. That bumps things up to at least a B+.
It's just so disappointing. And look, as I've been talking about these games this past month, there's one thing I've chosen not to bring up because I wanted to focus on what Nintendo actually chose to release. But let me quickly talk about my thoughts on the mods and fan ports of these games. I am a fan of the mods and fan ports of these games, even if I don't really play them myself, and they make Nintendo look like a bunch of chumps. The community has been out here making improvements to these games for years. These include amazing PC mods for 64 that, in addition to looking so damn good, are also in widescreen, or making Sunshine 60fps, or running Galaxy in 4K. What? These are passion projects that regular people are doing in their spare time for no money, while Nintendo spends real time and effort shutting them down and failing to even shove Super Mario Galaxy 2 onto a Switch cartridge. And yeah, I know that apparently Galaxy 2 features a lot of pointer-heavy stuff with Yoshi that might not work well on the Switch. I've never played that game, so I admit that I don't fully understand the issue, but could compromises really not be made? I don't know, I personally believe that Galaxy 2 isn't in this collection because Nintendo just didn't want to, not because they couldn't figure it out. Call me crazy, but I don't think Nintendo was trying to give us more than the bare minimum here, so sorry I have a hard time buying that excuse, but I've given up on giving them the benefit of the doubt from a business perspective a long time ago. I know I'm not the first person to say any of this stuff, and honestly, I'm an absolute hypocrite anyway. I'm still so glad that I can play these games portably while cooking rice or whatever, especially Sunshine. I happily bought the 3D collection the day it came out, the second Walmart opened in fact, and I mean it when I say that there was a line of over 20 of us all waiting to buy this single game. I didn't even mind them selling it for full price despite the collection probably being worth $40 tops. I was just so happy to have these games on Switch, because these are great f***ing games! And when I talked about 64 and Sunshine especially, I felt myself focusing on their negatives much more than I anticipated. But let me be clear, these are incredible, essential platforming experiences that I truly love, and my negative tone honestly stems from this shockingly lazy and almost offensive re-release. But besides me just wanting to complain, how does all of this tie into Galaxy? Well, on the surface it might look like it doesn't. Galaxy is easily the game in this collection that holds up the best. I mean, if you want to split hairs, the camera could be a little bit better, I guess, and handheld controls are a bit awkward, but they're manageable enough. Also, quick aside, but I wish you didn't unlock Rosalina's story so slowly. It cuts into some of her narrative's emotional impact when it's being drip-fed to you in mini-sized chunks, but I suppose I could have been smarter and just waited until I unlocked it all before reading it, but No, I'm not just being resentful here, it's Nintendo who's wrong. But anyway, while my issues with the collection might not seem as relevant to Galaxy, in my opinion, when an absolute masterpiece is included in a collection as pathetic as this one, it devalues the legacy of that game as well. This goes for 64 and Sunshine 2, obviously, but it's especially noticeable here. It gives the impression that these games aren't worth the extra time and effort, that they're consumer products that'll sell anyway, so who really cares? But that sucks, right? Like, treating such important games and also Sunshine like this, it just blows, you know? It's sad that Nintendo just doesn't care as much as we do, and it's disappointing that they prioritize profits this much when it comes to some of their most monumental titles. It legitimately makes me sad to see the fan community pouring their hearts into such incredible mods of these games, only to watch Nintendo erase all of their efforts like it's nothing. And at the end of the day, it's just hard to celebrate such beloved pieces of art when Nintendo treats the event like business as usual, available for a limited time, so you better just shut up and pay! And I think that's where I'm gonna wrap this up. Look, Super Mario Galaxy is very good, and a game as very good as this one deserves so much better than being featured in a collection as very bad as Super Mario 3D All-Stars. I truly hope that Nintendo prioritizes quality over profits for Mario's Big 5-0, but if we're lucky, we'll all be dead by then, so they won't even get the chance to screw it up. See you next time, DieAnt Squad, and thanks so much for watching.